students. In this video, we are going to see how this aluminium is extracted. Of course, we started off in the previous video. Those of you who have not watched that, the first step is something to do with Bayer's process, where this bauxite is converted in three steps. It comes down to pure alumina. That is where we are right now. Okay, so we start off from this pure alumina. Now, when you come to this alumina, it is aluminium oxide. As you see here, Al2O3, aluminium oxide. It's already in the oxide form. Stage 2 is not required. Now we go to stage 3. And the what is the stage 3? It is the reduction process. Stage 3 is nothing but reduction. What is reduction? Removal of oxygen is reduction. Okay, so that's what's going to happen here. And this process is called Hall-Herold's process. This is a very interesting story. Hall is an American, Herold is a French student. Both of them are about very young, about 22 years old. They were just trying experimentations in their own laboratory. And that is when they hit at this method. Because till such time, the electrolytic reduction of just alumina was very, very, very difficult. Actually, they say that during the time of Napoleon III, this was more costlier than gold. So he would have plates. That's what the story says. I don't know how far it is true, but he would have used aluminium bowls and plates and for himself. So that was the way this cost was for aluminium. And here came these two people who came out with a process that's named after them. That is where this is the third stage that happens. Okay. And this is called as Hall-Herold's process. And here, let us look into the electrolyte. Though we need to reduce aluminium oxide to aluminium, the melting point of just aluminium oxide, Al2O3, is 2050 degrees Celsius. That is the melting point. That is the point at which it will melt. Now you would ask me, why not just, you know, use a reducing agent? Why can't you use heat? See, remember, when you come to the reactivity series of metals, aluminium is one of the topmost reactive metal. So actually speaking, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the top 5 metals, they have a great affinity for oxygen, thereby forming stable metallic oxides. So they would not part, okay? It's not easy to separate the metal from the oxygen. That is where you can't use heat. Not any mild treatment is not possible. Another reducing agent is not possible. So it has to undergo electrolysis. And here it is not soluble. What do we do in electrolysis? Either the electrolyte should be in the aqueous form or in the fused state or the molten state. Aqueous form, not possible here because it is not soluble in water. So the only possibility is in the fused state or the molten state. And the melting temperature was so high as 2050 degrees. So came the solution here. These two people, they added something in addition to this alumina. What were they? Cryolite, that is sodium aluminium fluoride, and fluorspar, that is calcium fluoride. Okay, so that is cryolite, fluorspar, and alumina. These three made up the electrolyte. Now, once these two were added, there was magic that happened. Let's see what happened. You can see it here. The melting point came down from 2050 to 950. Isn't that great? Yeah, it reduces the amount of energy drastically. And it was so easy. So the method came down to be very easy after these two compounds were added. Not only that, this cryolite acted as a solvent, okay? It acts as a solvent. What do you mean by that? We just now saw that aluminium oxide is not soluble in water. So this cryolite started acting as a solvent. So it quickened the process of breaking down into ions. So it increases the conductivity, reduces the melting point. And once it breaks down into ions, what happens? It starts becoming free and mobile. So increases the mobility. So these are the advantages of adding cryolite and fluorspar in the ratio 1:3:1. Okay. Now let's move on to the electrolytic cell. This cell we can see from this diagram, it is a rectangular cell, okay? And here if you see, the anodes are made of carbon. Actually, there are in each rectangular cell, there are about 18 to 20 carbon rods that form the anode. So you can imagine the size of this electrolytic cell. And then the cathode also, though it's a steel tank, it is lined inside by carbon. So the anode is also made of carbon, the cathode is also made of carbon. Simple reason being, it's a high temperature and carbon is something that can withstand very high temperature. At the same time, not react much. Okay. Then there is also something, the powdered coke. You can see that right here, there's carbon powder, it is powdered coke. Now, what happens? What is the reason? See, when your mother gives you a hot cup of coffee or say Horlicks or whatever you're drinking, if it's going to get cold, what does mommy do? She will put a lid to the cup. Why does she put that lid? So that heat is not lost. Okay. So first reason is when you sprinkle this coke here, a carbon powder, it prevents loss of heat by radiation. That is possible. The second thing is at 950 degrees, it's pretty high temperature, isn't it? So at such temperatures, what can happen is this carbon, that is the rods, the anode rods, and the product at the anode is oxygen. We'll be seeing that shortly now. That oxygen can combine to give something called carbon monoxide, okay? And this carbon monoxide can further react with oxygen to give carbon dioxide. Two here, two. Yes, it's balanced. So this reaction is possible to prevent, you cannot totally prevent, but at least you can reduce or minimize, okay, the loss of the anodes. You can place this, sprinkle this coke on the top. So two reasons, prevent or minimize loss of heat by radiation and prevent or minimize the erosion of the anodes by this oxygen. Okay. All right. Next, anodes have to be periodically replaced. In this case, as I told you, there are many, many anodes in each cell and all these anodes undergo, let's go to the same equations, reactions that are happening here. Right on top, they start burning with a blue flame. Okay, in spite of all the sprinkling of coke powder and all that, still they start burning and time to time, these anodes are completely burnt up. They are eaten up, corroded. So they have to be replaced. Of course, they are recycled and then they are molded and they are replaced. Okay. Then this process is a continuous process. Why do we say it's continuous? Actually, what happens in the cell, it's connected to a battery and it's also connected to some bulbs. So the moment this electrolyte becomes lesser, the bulb starts glowing. Just like when a child will be playing and when the child becomes hungry, what does it do? It will start crying and screaming. Just like that, here, the moment the electrolyte gets lesser, it's completely getting over, on that verge, the bulb starts glowing. So it says, hey, it's time for electrolyte to be added and fresh electrolyte has to be added. And as you are adding it, the process continues. Actually, this process should not stop in between because when you stop it in between, it can solidify, it can form a solid and then it's very difficult to scrape it out. So this process continues for 365 days, 24 hours a day. So continuously, there is a continuous supply of aluminium. So next we'll go to the next process. That's the most important part, the electrolytic reactions. Thank you. Moving on to the electrolytic reactions, as we saw that the electrolyte is made of alumina, sodium aluminium fluoride and calcium fluoride. So all these three are involved. So when we dissociate them, alumina will dissociate into two aluminium ions, okay, plus three oxygen ions, that is oxide. If you come to cryolite, this breaks down to give three sodium ions and one aluminium ion plus six fluoride ions. Okay, calcium fluoride breaks down to give calcium plus two fluoride ions. So these are the dissociation reactions. Okay, now what are the ions present here? What are the cations present here? You see here, this is a cation, this also is a cation, and this is also a cation. So there are three cations present here. You have Al3 plus, sodium plus, and calcium ion. Three cations. Now let's go to the electrochemical series. Let us just brush up. The lower the position, the easier the discharge. There are three here, sodium is here, calcium is here, aluminium is here. So among the three, calcium, sodium and aluminium, aluminium is the lowest. So naturally, this would be discharged. Okay, all right. So that's what would happen at the cathode. Aluminium is discharged. Okay. All right, now let's go to the anode. We'll come to that a little shortly now. Anode. Here, what are the ions present? Oxygen is there and fluoride ion is there. And oxygen is lower. So naturally, oxygen will be discharged. Oxygen is discharged. Okay, now we need to know, what is the actual reaction happening? See here, out of all these ions present, the actual thing that's getting involved is aluminium and oxygen. So if we take a reaction this way, let us write it here. Aluminium oxide would break down to aluminium and oxygen. This is the reaction that's happening. If we balance this, what do we get? 2 here, then 4 aluminium atoms and 6, therefore 3. So this is the actual breakdown process that is happening here. So how many do we need? We need 4 aluminium atoms. Remember, when it gets finally comes down, the product is neutral atoms of aluminium and oxygen. It's not in the ionic form. So how do you convert it? These four aluminium ions are taken, and how many electrons have to be added? 3 into 4, that is 12 electrons to give you four aluminium atoms. You get that right? So that's a product that is formed at the cathode. And once it is formed at the cathode, this is in the molten state, it just comes and it's getting collected here. So that is molten aluminium that is coming out. And then coming to the anode part, how many oxygen atoms are there? Molecules are formed are 3 molecules, a total of 6 atoms. Okay, so here 6 oxygen ions, oxide ions. So it has 12 electrons in excess, which it has to give up. That gives you 6 oxygen atoms. And you know that oxygen cannot exist monoatomic. It has to be diatomic. That is 2 atoms in a molecule. That gives you 3 O2. And it is a gas that is released on the top. So see here, 4 aluminium atoms are there. 3 oxygen molecules are also formed. So this is the electrolytic reaction that happens in Hall-Héroult's process, and the product at the cathode is aluminium metal that is about 99% pure. This is further electro-refined, that's the stage 4, again to get pure aluminium that is 99.9% pure. Now we move on to the topic alloy. Okay, what is an alloy? See, supposing you want a team, a quiz team to be selected in your from your class. Okay, the team would comprise of one who is very good at mathematics, one who is very good at science, and you would pick up somebody who is very good at art. So like that, you will pull up the best, the desired properties. Similarly here, it is a homogeneous mixture of two or more metals. What all are you going to see? The desired property should be there, and also in the right proportion, because the word homogeneous, it should be a homogeneous mixture, means it must be in the right proportion. That's an alloy. And coming to the alloys of aluminium, there are two alloys, only two to remember, magnesium and duralium. Magnesium, Al is aluminium. So it's very easy to remember this. And the maximum majority is 95%. The chief constituent is aluminium and 5% of magnesium. This is used in the aircraft and scientific tools. The next one alloy is duralium, which also is made up of 95% aluminium, but along with magnesium 0.5%, manganese 0.5%, and 4% copper is also added here. And this is also used in aircraft and also in pressure cookers. Okay. The reason here is, see, if you take aluminium, aluminium is always known for its lightness. Okay. And also sturdy. It is light, at the same time it is sturdy. Sometimes some people who are very thin, but they are strong. It's like that. And magnesium is known for its strength. So you're adding a little bit of more strength is given to aluminium, because when it's used in the aircraft, what happens? It needs to be, it'll be exposed to a lot of pressure differences, isn't it? Turbulences. So this has to be sturdy and stable, and that is why we add all these other elements. That's what the alloys are about. So the reason for adding these together, pulling them together, is because they are light, at the same time hardness, and then corrosion resistant. Okay, so with that we finish this on alloys. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you have enjoyed, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Bye-bye.